Thank you very much for this kind introduction. I'm very happy and very thankful that I've been invited again to Korea. I'm happy to be here. This time I was even faster than my luggage when I came in this morning. Well, basic science, fundamental technology research and innovation. We have heard a lot about it, so I think we can consider that this is not a real question that we should pose. It is. Basic science is a powerhouse of innovation. It is the base, it is the beginning of everything. I think this was very clear during the speeches we heard. So I would a little bit more focus on, after some words of introduction, about how the gap can be bridged that Peter Fulde just mentioned. The gap between basic science and, well, industry, at least, because at the end of the day, innovation means that we get new products, we get new processes, we get new services that are accepted by the market. Some people say that this is the only and the right definition for innovation. I don't think so. It's much broader. It's much broader, and if we take as a definition, something that I heard a long time ago, it's very simple. It is to see what everybody sees and to think what nobody has thought before. And this is a very simple, a very nice the definition about of the definition of innovation, and it is exactly what basic science is about: to see what everybody sees and to think what no one and nobody has thought before. In the traditional way, we have seen, or this has already been mentioned, we have seen a staircase, a three-step innovation, as I call it, beginning with basic science, fundamental technology research, but mainly within universities. Big research institutes, a lot of them have been mentioned. I was very happy last week to visit CERN in Geneva. CERN is one of the most exciting, the basic research labs that we have in the world. They are running a cyclotron of 27 kilometers, and they are shooting protons with I think it's protons. I'm not a lawyer. I'm not a scientist, so I may be wrong. But they are shooting protons with light speed, nearly light speed, and make them crash. And so they simulate the Big Bang that started our universe. If you are ever in Switzerland, you should go there and visit them. They have a very nice presentation, and you go out of these buildings and you have a different view on our world and maybe on your life. Well, this is the very beginning, I think. These institutes, they are working on the real things, on the basic things. We have a second step, applied research, applied sciences. Some have also been mentioned, Fraunhofer, for example. There are universities of applied research labs that try to transfer basic technologies into, well, maybe products or maybe services, and we have the products and services that are finalized within industry. This three-step approach is, from my point of view, is changing, is speeding up to a two-step innovation. And this is also mentioned already. We see much more often. A development where basic research institutes start to work directly with industry more and more. And I think this is something that is leading to new products and services much faster than we have seen them in the past. And it's exciting to see how this can be done and how this can work. We have within this two-step innovation system, we see that universities and research labs start their own business. At the first view, this sounds like a contradiction, because we have just heard scientists working in basic science, they are the pure scientists. They are independent. They do not think of market issues, of marketable products, of any relevance for industry. But it changes. CERN, that you mentioned in Geneva, has recently set up a technology transfer agency within their own organization. We see in Heidelberg, where we have a number of basic research institutes, like the German Cancer Research Center, European Molecular Biology Lab especially, they start their own activities in the business field. And this means, just an example from the European Molecular Biology Lab, EMBL, they have started a venture capital fund. They have started a financial service for startups, and they spin off a number of companies in the meantime, with the technical and business support done by a company that EMBL started just for this purpose. The name is Emblem. Emblem is in the word. So, but they try to do something that makes things faster regarding their way to the market. One company just of EMBL, named Zelzome, has just been acquired by GSK, GlaxoSmithKline, and they got a lot of money for that, that they could reinvest in new basic science research programs. So this is a very interesting activity that is going on in the moment, and I think we have to deal with that. The side of starting their own business, we see a number of activities that create a kind of a new fertile ground for future cooperation. It starts with knowledge sharing. Also an example from our place, from Heidelberg. We have seen that since a number of years, there is a platform to meet, a platform of researchers from industry and from the basic research institutes. By the way, they talk German, but I don't understand the word because it's so specific. And they have a chat every half a year about that, one day, and then they talk about what they have achieved in their research activities. My feeling was that in the beginning, I joined this meeting since many years, and it was always fascinating not to understand the word, nearly not to understand the word, and being aware that they are talking German. So I went there. And my feeling was that from one meeting to the other, they began to be more and more open. This was a kind of stepping into a kind of a trusted community or a trusted collaboration. I think this is a really exciting thing, and maybe we will be able to bridge the gap if we can organize this, or we can stimulate this more often. It is something that works. We have seen that in addition to knowledge sharing of people who work in the field of basic research and fundamental technology research, the next step is that they start companies. They start joint research units. Mostly they do it as companies, but they are not producing anything. They are doing basic research. We have some examples also in our place. BASF, the big chemical company, and the University of Heidelberg, they have started such a company within the premises of our technology park. Another example is a rather big activity. It's also a company, a limited company, called Innovation Lab. And partners of Innovation Lab are the universities of Heidelberg, of Mannheim, the Karlsruhe Institute of Technology, which is a new big unit from a basic research unit in Karlsruhe, from a nuclear research unit, and the university, a technical university. And Merck, Serono, pharmaceutical company, BASF, SAP, information technology, and Heidelberg Printing. It's quite funny, they are working on new ideas how to create new organic material that is electronically sensible. And Heidelberg Printing is looking for papers that they can print, that they want to print a TV on a paper that you can put on the wall. So this is a very, very visionary activity, but, and it is still in the field of basic research, as far as I understand it. So they do not work for products, they do not work for, even for, but they do work for product ideas maybe, but they have to deal with basic research issues, and they all do this together. If you look at this big number of participants and companies and research labs working together, it is quite obvious that this is really a challenge. How to bring them together, how to bring them to, well, we often talk about open-minded talks and open-minded collaboration. This is a wonderful word, but try this in practice. It is very, very difficult. Therefore, I love the word open innovation, but open innovation at the moment doesn't take place. It is so difficult to create an environment where this can happen. And let me talk a little bit about this and our experience that we have in Heidelberg. So we see that this has already also been mentioned. We see two cultures in industry and in basic sciences. The two cultures, publishing versus secrecy. By the way, within these chats that I mentioned, this is really life. A researcher from a science lab talks very open about everything that they have just found out, and as he knows that his counterpart from industry is working in the same field, he realizes that this is not really answering. This industry guy, if you ask him, will say, "Well, I'm sorry, we are just in a patenting process, we have to secure our intellectual property first, we cannot talk further." So this is a very, very difficult situation, and as you mentioned, the gap, we have to work on that. The academic side, basic research has some, well, basics about their self-understanding. They are very often even forced to publish everything. They have to inform the public. You mentioned that. This is right. The CERN in Geneva, for example, they are not allowed to patent anything. They have to publish everything they find out, because the number of countries, there's more than 20 countries that are financing CERN, they have legally put down in the constitution of this basic research lab that everything that they find out is public. Every country can use that. So you will see it's very difficult to find a way then to commercialize one day something out of what they're getting out of their research. Another point, scientists working in basic science in our universities and labs are getting their reputation by publishing. The citation index is what counts, and not the number of patents that they have been working on. Totally contrary on industry, where we also see basic research activities, they are have to keep things secret until they have their patents and their secrecy agreements and whatever. But we need to bridge this gap. And as I mentioned, I think there's only one way. And this one way is that we have to stimulate the relevant actors from both sides that they can trust each other. This is not only signing a secrecy agreement, because many people consider this as a kind of a paper and they do not trust the paper. It takes time, it takes It needs activities where they meet, where they meet again and again, and then one day you will see that it will work, and this will be fruitful for both sides. One interesting activity that makes people or fastens this pathway, this process, is something that we have seen in Europe, especially in Germany in the last 15-20 years. Big government fundings for specific scientific activities have been launched, and they have launched competitions between those the government wants to bring together. So if the government or the European Union, the European Commission says, I want that in biotechnology, for example, in specific clusters, industry and basic research institutes, universities work together. And they launch a competition where only those are invited who work together and show that they will work together. And you put not just some pennies into it or some cents, but a reasonable amount of money, then this also may work. We have seen a very successful example. It was a so-called bioregio competition in the last years of the last century, 1995-96 was launched. This was such a competition. And we brought together the universities, number of universities and industry, the pharmaceutical industry. And what happened in the first meetings was that no one really wanted to talk about what he has in mind and what he found out, what should be presented in this competition. But there was something happening that we had not seen such an importance. They all thought, everyone, that we were quite good in our region, and therefore they wanted to win. And from meeting to meeting, the will to win this competition and to get the money, it was 600 million euro at that time, not only for us, but for some others also, but it was a real big amount of money. As everyone wanted to win, and this will went stronger from meeting to meeting, they started to trust each other, and they started to sign secrecy agreements, to sit together, and at the end of the day evaluation groups, 50% scientists, 50% from industry, and they screened every project, and they worked fantastically together, and this was a beginning of a kind of a trusted community. If I say we, then this was an activity that we mainly pushed from the Heidelberg Technology Park. The Heidelberg Technology Park is not only an incubator, we are an incubator, but it is a place where we have small companies, big companies. From the very beginning we had scientific institutes, we had the university with some labs in the building, so there was already a base where communication took place. This, I think, can be a model how to bridge the gap, the possibility to use institutions like technology parks, or how you call them, innovation cities or technology cities, or the name doesn't matter, but organizations where science and business can meet on the same level, and can use the opportunities that this this park or institution offers. We have always had basic science, fundamental technology research, applied sciences, and companies with new products and services, small and startups, small ones and bigger ones. So there was already a base, but this is not enough. If you have buildings, we have a number of buildings. 50,000 square meter lab and office space. So they people don't meet. They go in the morning to their office, and then in the afternoon they go home. So it needs more. It needs more. It needs opportunities. It needs stimulation. It needs meetings. It needs places where people want to be and want to go. What is that? We have found out, for example, that a kindergarten is a fantastic place for communication. We have a kindergarten where mainly it's a private kindergarten where the researchers from both sides take their children in the morning, they bring them, and in the afternoon they get them back, and on the weekends they do something together. So they talk and they are coming together. We did not expect that, but it's working fantastic. Another thing is a restaurant. I remember one guy from Finland, he was responsible for Nokia, for setting up research parks. And he said, the first thing I'm doing is a shop and a restaurant. Because people always, especially the researchers, forget to buy the milk they want to drink in the evening. And so they need a shop for all these things that they normally forget. And the restaurant is a place where you need something like that. My dream is a beer garden. I have never been able to make this happen because the Cancer Research Center, which has been with his basic research labs in our park, in the premises of the park, said, we do not want alcohol in our area around. So only alcohol-free beer could be something. But I don't think that in Germany, the beer garden only with alcohol-free beer will work. So we have not been able to put this into reality. We have basic science units, as I mentioned. We have the labs from fundamental technology and industry. We have applied sciences. We have these market companies. The actors from these companies, they meet each other. They meet in the floors, in our restaurant, in our restaurant, and take their children into the kindergarten and all that. We have also companies in the meantime founded by basic science units. Companies that are founded by EMBL, for example, European Molecular Biology Lab, they come down to the technology park and use the labs and the offices that we can offer. We have companies founded by universities and research institutes together with industry in fundamental technology fields in the park. And this really works. So I think that bringing people together from all these actors together, from all these different areas, will create what we need. This feeling that they belong together, that there is a community that is working from basic research to all the activities that are needing to find new ideas about new products, new services, new processes. And I think this is something that may be able to bridge the gap. The recent new idea is that we now are setting up to make science, to market acceleration, the own business of a science and technology park. This is something, to say it in a simple way, technology parks, incubators, technology areas, centers offer normally lab and office space and services. Maybe they help in financial aspects and do more or less support for their companies. The new idea is not only to offer lab and office space, but also scientific teams, scientific staff. We had a project in the last half year that I tell you just this example, that a big pharmaceutical company, the Max Serono, wanted to focus on a very specific scientific field, basic research. And they needed a multidisciplinary team for that. And they were not able to organize that. So a company in our technology park has set up a legal entity, and this legal entity is a contracted partner now of Merck Serono. And this legal entity organizes everything. They use the premises of the park, everything, what's lab and technical support, everything about what's there. And they have, by an assessment center, they have found the around 15 young researchers from all over the world to do this job for 3 years. The industry is financing, and another legal entity, in this case a company in our park, has taken over the role to organize the whole and the staff and everything that's around to make this research project happen. This is something new, and it's something that a research park in the future also can start with. There's a new model, but I think it will accelerate the process a lot, because big pharma, big company, in our case is mainly pharma because we have a big life science background. I think that this will accelerate the process, because it is easy for everyone who is part of this game to organize that. A big pharmaceutical company will have some difficulties to organize multidisciplinary teams where maybe someone from geography is needed, or people from completely different areas where they have no knowledge about how to get them. If we can organize that, then I think things will work a little bit better and faster. So, science and technology parks can drive innovation by including basic science, fundamental technology research in their communities, in their collaborating actors, and this is, I think, one way we can try to bridge the gap. Thank you very much. This is an invitation to visit our place. It's nice in spring, nice in autumn, and every time. Not only for science, but also for living. And you will meet a lot of, this is the only commercial in my speech, you will find a lot of Korean citizens visiting Heidelberg all the year through. Thank you very much.